So the video I'm going to shoot today is how to get rid of your points distributor and wire up an electronic distributor. And also, I'm going to use a GM ignition module to do it. And what this does is it allows me to eliminate the ballast resistor. If you want to keep your ballast resistor and keep your factory wiring, it's a good start on how to wire in the factory HEI ignition module, the 5-pin or 4-pin. It's not much different than removing this, but it allows me to basically bypass the ballast resistor and use those cables to fire the spark with this GM ignition module. We'll see how it goes. It's very simple. So let's go over a parts list. So here's basically all the parts that I need to do this conversion from HEI using the GM module. It's very simple. I have a big block 383. So you'll need a big block HEI distributor. Any mid-70s 400 will work because the 400 is the low deck. 440 might, I think they use the same distributor, I don't know. But if you have the big block, the Cardone part number is 303897. Small blocks will be a different distributor, but the cap and the rotor are the same for the big blocks, whether it's points or ignition or HEI. And it's also true for small blocks. If you're moving from points to HEI for a small block, like a 318 or a 360, well, you won't have a 360 with points. It's going to use the same distributor cap. Your small block and big block are different, but points and HEI are the same. Anyway, you'll need an ignition module, whether you use the 5-pin or the GM. You'll need a new coil because the resistance is different. Now this is a 1.4 ohm coil. It'll work fine, even though it's not going to have as much spark as this GM module can technically handle. And then you'll need some wiring. Now the nice thing about these HEI Chrysler distributors is they use this guy right here, which is a pretty standard 2-pin connector. You can get them anywhere trailer lights are sold, or I actually went to my junkyard, and my junkyard had a 76 Grand Fury, and I cut off the nice thing about those late model emissions, late 70s emissions, is I cut off all these little connectors. So I made my own loom to wire this guy up. I cut off the distributor connectors, I cut off about 6 or 7 of these guys, I cut off an alternator connector so I can put in an alternator. I made a second wire loom to hook my coil up, so these are the parts that you're basically going to need to do this conversion. You might need a couple extra wires for the 5-pin connector if you plan on keeping your ballast resistor. But I'm going to bypass the ballast resistor, so you're going to need to make a jumper that jumpers those connections. Now, the ballast we'll get into that later when we go under the hood, but I'm going to show you how to wire this guy up now. It's very simple for this HEI module. So here's the wiring, and this is all you need to hook this thing up. The non-exposed pin of this connector, this top one, this non-exposed one, goes to the tiny connector on the top. And then the exposed pin connects to the bottom connector here on this ignition module. And then I have the colors, red is always positive, and then this is the negative for the coil. So this top connector goes to the positive for the coil, and then the bottom connector goes to the negative for the coil. Now, as long as you jumper your ballast resistor, your coil will have the positive wire that feeds the ignition feed for this cable. So you just leave the cable on the positive side and connect this cable to it. So the important thing to remember is that this terminal right here, this round terminal that I'm pointing to, needs to be grounded. So I will jumper this directly to a chassis ground because I don't plan on grounding the mount. And also, I'm going to have to grind these nubs off, these nubs, so that this can lay flat on a piece of aluminum so that heat can be sinked away from it. All ignition modules come with grease to put on the back and transfer this heat away. If you don't have any of this grease, then you can use just dielectric grease or CPU grease if you're a computer guy. But when I mount this, I'm going to have to make sure that there's contact there to sink heat away. And also, this has to be grounded, so I'm going to have a wire just going. So let's go under the hood, and I'll show you the connections that we're going to make on the ballast resistor. Some additional things that I wanted to point out for the wiring is that if you don't have any of these fancy connectors or whatever, you can use regular butt connectors. It just looks like you use regular butt connectors to make those connections. They do fit on there. They work fine. The other thing I wanted to point out is that you're going to need jumper wires to jump over the ballast resistor. Once you unplug the cables from the ballast resistor, you'll need to connect them together to make sure because that's the ignition feed from the key to the ignition. So if you have a single ballast resistor like me, you'll need one. If you have a dual ballast resistor, you'll need to jumper both to continue working. My setup's going to be a little different, but I'm going to set it up like this to show you that it will work. So here's a little theory about Mopar ignition that we'll get into. This is actually the voltage regulator, and this is the old one. This is not the electronic one. And this is the ballast resistor. And the wiring is fairly simple. It's actually the same whether you have the 5-pin, the dual ballast resistor, or if you have the new voltage regulator or not. The wiring is basically the same, except the dual ballast resistor has an extra row up here for the extra pin on the ignition module. But the wiring diagrams for the two pin resistors is easy to find, but it's I've never seen it for this older pre-69 and older cars. Anyway, the wiring is very simple. You need two sets of voltages. You have to have voltage to run the coil, and then you have to have voltage to run the coil while it's cranking. So this white wire is the main ignition wire from the key, and it's called ignition one. So when you see ignition one, that's the run position. So this is run ignition. This blue wire goes to the side of the ballast resistor. So this wire right here is the same as this wire right here. It actually just runs right over here to this side of the ballast resistor. So the ignition feed for the alternator voltage regulator is the same feed that runs the ballast resistor. Now on this side, so this is 12 volts and then it goes through the resistor. Now this black cable here on the right goes to the coil. So this is your 8 volts to the coil after it's been resisted. This brown wire is actually ignition 2, which is the start position. This brown wire has 12 volts when the engine is cranking. That's what this brown wire does. This is basically a bypass right here so that the coil can have voltage while the engine is cranking. So these two wires are actually connected to the same location so that the coil wire always has voltage. You got that? This brown wire is called ignition 2. So when you see that in the diagram, this is ignition 2. And this is basically ignition 1 that's jumpered from the voltage regulator. So what we're going to do is we're going to unplug these two and jumper them with that little splice. And basically, that will provide constant 12 volts to the coil and provide the power when we hook the positive side of the ignition module up to the coil. So that's basically a rundown of Mopar ignition. Now, there's a couple extra wires for the electronic ignition, the dual ballast resistor, but the bottom side of the ballast resistor is hooked up just like this. It's only the top one that's different, the top two pins on the double ballast resistor. So basically all we're going to do is we're going to jumper this guy and then put in the new distributor and hook up the wires to the coil. And it'll get its ignition feed from this wire to this wire. It'll run fine. I don't even know if that makes any sense. You can find diagrams. I can't put a diagram up because I don't own a copyrighted diagram. It's pretty simple. If I get frisky, I'll make one in Paint and put one up. And don't forget to disconnect the battery cable. Notice how this ignition rotor is pointed just before the clip. And it's basically pointed right at the bolt for the condenser, mounted to the side of the coil in that direction. We're just gonna make sure that when the new rotor goes in, the new distributor goes in, it's gonna be in that same orientation. So funny story about distributors when you take them out on a car you just drove to the garage, they are really hot. Also, you want to make sure that your distributor has an O-ring, because sometimes the remanufactured ones ship without one. Since we are getting rid of the external resistor, we have to make sure that the coil we have is internally resisted, even though that ignition module could probably run a low impedance coil. But this off-the-shelf brand is internally resistant. Okay, so let's do a real quick overview. I finished hooking everything up. I got the distributor back in. I've jumpered my connection. I have my harness hooked up to the positive and the negative sides of the coil. I have my connector connected to the distributor. And then out here, I have the connectors hooked up to the ignition module, and I've grounded it to the firewall. Just temporarily, before I find a place to mount it, I want to see if it'll even run. So I should be in a condition where I can start this up. So I'm going to set up the tripod and we'll see if she runs. Stand by. I don't know if it'll start. The timing might be off. Good. I think that noise was the fact that the oil pump is hooked to the distributor and she had to prime or step up or whatever. But we know the distributor's spinning and it appears that oil pressure made it back into the engine. So we'll see how it goes. Looks like she runs good though. The ignition module isn't getting warm yet and the wire almost fell right into the pulley. So that would have been great. I'm just feeling the ignition module to see if it's warming up, because it's not a heat sink right now. Runs pretty good. Yeah, it's a little warm. It's not bad though, but you know, it's just kind of set up. So what I'm gonna do is I'm basically gonna find a place to mount the ignition module and we'll get everything finalized. Looks like it's okay. I mean, I might get stuck somewhere, but it is running, so that's a bonus. Which means that the ignition module is tripping the distributor and telling the spark plugs to fire. So the one thing that I've done is I've actually got it to run. I still have to mount the ignition module, but I wanted to make a final note. I didn't tune it up or change the distributor cap because I didn't want to change 100 things all at once. And also, it's good to gap your plugs at 45 instead of 35 because points is set to run at 35. So it should run a little better with a bigger points gap. It's not going to make that big a difference. I might see a little difference if I got a low impedance coil, but for right now, I'm happy. I'm happy it started. I'm happy I'm going to be able to get home because it'd be a long walk because I had to go to a garage out of town. But stay tuned because I'm going to do a video on how to wire up a modern alternator because technically I've already bypassed the ballast resistor, so there's no more ballast resistor. That air compressor scared the crap out of me. But anyway, stay tuned for a few more videos on how to do engine stuff to Plymouths, to Mopars. It's pretty hard to find videos about Mopar stuff.